Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
We thank you so much, Lord, for our brother Aaron. And Lord, I would just ask that you would use him this morning as you used our brother Aaron from so long ago, Lord, who spoke with Moses. And thank you, Father, for the message this morning, Lord. I pray that we'll apply it to our lives, Father God. We know that the harvest is great, but the workers are few. So, Lord, we would pray for more workers in your harvest field. We thank you, Father, so much for our time together this morning. We ask that you bless each and every heart. Father, you know what the needs are, Father. You know what heart needs what. And, Father, you know that you can meet those needs because we put all of our faith and our trust in you. Maranatha, Father, Hosanna, we pray, Father, send your son soon. And until he comes, Lord, help us to be about your work. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, we give thanks and pray. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Barnes. All right, guys. If you guys want to get your Bibles out, we're going to be in mostly in the book of Acts today. I love the book of Acts because it talks about the early church. You know, after Jesus died and raised from the dead, and it shows in many different ways how the gospel goes out as Jesus predicted. And we're actually gonna look at a little bit of Luke. I don't know if you knew this, but Luke and Acts were both written by the same author. And John's kind of the Gospel of John's right in the middle of it. So it's like a two-part volume. You've got the Gospel of Luke, where he talks about Jesus' life and death and resurrection, and then he continues on what happens with the early church. It's pretty cool. And anybody here ever experienced double vision? Well, we're going to have a different kind of double vision. We're going to see a vision by two different men, one Jew and one Gentile. And we're going to see how God uses that to expand the gospel. It was first, salvation came first to the Jews and then to the Gentiles. We're going to see that today. And I'm actually going to, before we get started, I want to tell you, I had the opportunity to go to a Jewish wedding many years ago. I met Elon first day of vet school. I met in the courtyard and we have become good friends. And I grew up in the Pacific Northwest. We don't have many Jewish people. It's kind of a real Jewish community. So I didn't know any Jews before, but I got to know Elon and what a great friend he's been. And I learned a little bit about the culture. You know, he taught me, for example, about the kashrut, which is the Jewish dietary laws that would give them rules of what they could eat or not eat. For example, anything that comes from the water has to have fins or scales. So tuna is okay. Salmon's okay. No lobster, no clams, no crabs, more for the Gentiles. And then they don't eat the blood, right? So when they kill an animal, they do a very quick slice through the neck. That way the blood comes out. And it may sound weird, but it's actually considered by many to be one of the most humane ways to kill an animal. In 2 seconds, they're unconscious. So because in the Jewish law, they weren't to eat the blood. They weren't to partake of the blood. Because the life was in the blood. The soul was in the blood. So they weren't to take that in and ingest it. I also learned some things about you don't eat meat and milk together. In fact, a good Jewish kitchen has a set of pots and pans for meat and a set of pots and, you know, pans and utensils for milk. You don't mix them. They can have them in the same day, but you know, typically many hours apart. And there are a number of these rules. And as I spent time around him, I started to learn about these things. I always thought it was kind of ironic because when I was in vet school, I had a strong interest in pigs. And who's my good friend? A Jewish guy who can't eat pigs. So, you know, and the reason why pigs are unclean is because when it comes to mammals, they have to have split hooves, and they have to chew their cud. So a pig has split hooves, but they don't chew their cud. And you know, camel has they chew their cud, but they don't have a split hoof. So So as I spent time around him, I got to know this. And then after I was here for a few years, I had the opportunity to, I was invited to go to his wedding. And he met this great lady, Meg, and they live in Denver. And in fact, his son is named after me. Pretty privileged, Aaron. What a great kid. Even better if you met him, because you'd go, wow, he's even an improvement from you, man. But I've never been to a Jewish wedding, so I don't know what to expect. I go there. I've been here for a couple of years, wearing Aloha shirts. Now I got to go put on a suit and tie. I had to kind of struggle to even find one. And I go there. It's in the summertime. It's in Denver in the middle of the day. We're outside. The honor was I got to be one of the huppa tent holders. Now I didn't even know what this was until I got there, but there are tents kind of not unlike this. In fact, they're modeled. The huppa tents are modeled after Abraham. Abraham, the father of the Jewish faith, he was known for hospitality. And if you notice, these tents, like we have here, they're open on all sides, so very approachable. And this huppa tent was like a covering over the family. You know, this new couple starting a family was symbolic of that. And so, all four of us at each corners were all Gentiles. Now, this is where I'll divert a little bit. Tell you a little bit of embarrassing stuff about myself, because you'll understand in a minute why. I've got a really slow heart rate. And so I have a tendency to pass out. And I've got some pretty embarrassing stories. Not so embarrassing, but one time when I was in my parents' bathroom, I passed out standing up and, you know, hit my head and fell to a heap on the back later on, wake up a few minutes later. I always struggle with dizziness. In fact, I was just thinking this last week, I was out laying down some brick out behind the house, and I get up quick, and I'm like, oh, yeah, there's that dizzy feeling that I tend to feel. Well, freshman year of college, I'm in an all-men's dorm. I've been sick for a few days, so I'm all sweaty and gross. I'm like, I'm going to go take a shower. Well, the shower wasn't in my room. It was down the hallway. So I go in the shower, taking a shower, and I pass out in the shower. And I wake up, and I'm the water's coming in, and I'm like, I kind of panicked to turn off the water, I think. I grab my towel, open up the door, and setting down the hallway to my room, and I pass out. In fact, I got a rug burn on my face from the. Now, you would think in an all-men dorm, good chance of the first one being there being a guy. No, it would be my friend's girlfriend, and she never looked at me the same way again. It was very disturbing. Okay, moving on. So, freshman year of vet school, I'm getting ready for a four-hour gross anatomy final. And I'm sitting down, I ask one of my classmates a question. She starts to answer. And you ever had that thing where somebody's talking to you and you're trying to act like you're paying attention, but you're not really paying attention? It's because I got this massive chest pain, and I started to like feel weird, so I stood up and down I go. Pass out on the floor. One of my more dramatic classmates said I was seizuring, but clearly not. So I gotta go up, and I knock on the door where they're prepping this. I mean, it's intimidating. It's a pretty scary test. But I didn't feel like I was. Stress probably played a role. But anyway, I knock on the door, and they look. She looked at me. That one of the professors, and she said, "You look white as a ghost." I'm like, "Well, I just passed out, and so I need to go." And they're like, "Well, we'll change the test for you." I'm like, "No. I'm getting on a plane tomorrow. I'm coming back for this thing." So. In fact, that was, I became, my wife was a year behind me, and I became the notorious, infamous passer-outer because our tests are so hard that, so she would later find out that I was that guy. That's your embarrassment. So anyway, I kind of have this reputation of passing out. Now, back to the story, because now it kind of matters. So I'm here, I've got a full suit and tie on, I'm out in the sun. I mean, you have a tent, but where I'm standing, I'm in the sun still. Now, I don't know how long this is supposed to last, but I quickly realize I'm in trouble. I had not too long into this, I've sweated through my entire shirt and my coat, soaked to the bone. Now my feet are burning, and I remember standing there going, I don't know, I don't want this Gentile to ruin it for a Jewish wedding. They're never going to let us back again. So as I'm trying to figure out an escape route, I'm like, what's the best way for me to not make a fool of myself and ruin this whole day? So I'm like, well, I could sit down here, but that'd be kind of awkward because you're up in front of everybody. I tried to get the attention of the best man, but he was a little too far away without being completely awkward. I'm looking at my wife, thinking she can bail me out. And I look over her. She doesn't care. She doesn't see me at all. She's got this great view of the couple right there in front of her. She's not looking at me. My other comrades are on the corners. They're not watching me at all. So I'm like, oh Lord, please don't let this Gentile ruin it. And if I didn't mention it already, and you don't know, Jews and Gentiles. If you're not a Jew, you're a Gentile. It's that simple. So here I am, this Gentile, here wondering, like, please Lord, don't let it happen. Well, I told you all the background so you could be watching this journey, walking through this journey with me. And in truth, the Lord bailed me out. I did not actually, that's as close to passing out as I've ever come without actually doing it. Thank you, Lord. And when my wife finally did look it over me, when I was starting to feel a little bit better, she said, I had no lips. My color of my lips was the same as my white skin. And that was when I was feeling better. Well, thank God for intervening and keeping that relationship between the Jew and the Gentile okay. Well, what we're going to look at today is the relationship between the Jews and the Gentiles. Now, the Gentiles, we're not clean. We're not clean at all. And, you know, the Jews don't really, they really have a view of salvation is for the Jewish people. God, you know, I was always jealous of Elon because he was part of the Jewish people were God's chosen people. If most of, I look around, I'm guessing most of you are Gentiles. We're not God's chosen people. Now, we'll get to that in a minute, but I was like, man, that would be so cool to be a part of God's chosen people, to be Jewish. But we're going to look, now I'm going to actually start at the end of Luke. And I mentioned already, Luke wrote both Gospel of Luke and Acts. And we're going to see, we're going to look at the end of Luke. So let's go. What is that? This is Luke 24, verse 36. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish. He took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witness of these things. I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high." Okay, that's the end of first volume. Now flip over to Luke, or to Acts, the beginning of Acts chapter 1. All right, guys, this is the continuation. And I didn't mention this already, but he's writing both books to Theophilus. I love that. Theophilus is thought to actually be a real person, a real name, but the meaning is lover of God. I think that's pretty cool because anybody who's a lover of God is going to love what he wrote about. All right, so let's read Acts chapter 1:1. "In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up into heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After this suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command, 'Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father has promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' So they met together. So when they met together, they asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." Keep that in mind. All right? We're going to look here. We're going to move forward a little bit to chapter 2. We're going to look at the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit's been coming. That's the power that they're talking about, okay? So let's read on. 2, verse 1. "When the day of Pentecost came, they were all gathered together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fires that separated and came to rest on them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in tongues as the Spirit enabled." Now, Peter will go on to explain. If you want to go back later and read further, you'll see that Peter's explaining. He's like, these guys aren't drunk. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. This is the Holy Spirit coming on. And what these guys, the guys that were around this group of people, were hearing God's name praised in their language. There were people that had come to Jerusalem from all over the world, and they were all hearing these people talk in tongues, but they were understandable to each culture, each dialect that was there. They would hear these praises that were being praised to God. And this is what Jesus said, "Lest I go away, I can't send the helper." And this is what they've been waiting for. They started in Jerusalem. The Jewish disciples, the apostles, they were waiting for this power to come on high. And just like Jesus instructed, they waited. Now it's arrived. And who did it arrive to? The Jewish people. But what we're going to see today is that God is going to use a vision, one for a Gentile, one for a Jew, and he's going to expand that. This Holy Ghost, this is going to be not just for the Jews, but for the Gentiles as well. Now, this is the part we're going to really focus on today. I want you to turn to chapter 10 of Acts, and I want you to pay attention, and we'll come back. We'll talk a little bit as we go, too. So first, we're going to begin with Cornelius. At Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion in what was known as the Italian regiment. He and all his family were devout and God-fearing. He gave generously to those in need and prayed to God regularly. One day at about 3 p.m, he had a vision. He distinctly saw an angel who came to him and said, "Cornelius." Cornelius stared at him in fear. "What is it, Lord?" he asked. The angel said, "Your prayers and gifts to the poor have come up as a memorial offering before God. Now send men to Joppa to bring back a man named Simon who was called Peter. He is staying with Simon the tanner, whose house is by the sea." Interesting. Peter was one of those closest disciples to Jesus, one of the kind of the inner three, Peter, James, and John, remember? And so Peter is going to be, he's actually one of the leaders of, the major leader of the early Jewish church in Jerusalem. And I think it's funny because he's going to be used, most of his ministry is going to be to the Jew, but here he's going to be used to reach out to the Gentile people. And we talked about cleanliness, right? Easy for a Jew to get unclean. And one of the ways to do that is to be around somebody who's, if you handle dead animal, dead bodies, you're unclean. And who is he staying with? A tanner. What do? Deal with dead bodies. So I think God's already kind of getting him a little bit ready, maybe more ready than he realizes at the time. Well, let's read on. When the angel spoke to him, had gone, Cornelius called two of his servants and a devout soldier who was one of his attendants. He told them everything that had happened and sent them to Joppa. Now, meanwhile, Peter. About noon the following day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the roof to pray. That was something that a lot of times they didn't have other areas, so they go up to the rooftop, and that would be a place where they could have some privacy. Well, he became hungry and wanted something to eat. While the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven opened and something like a large sheet being let down to the earth by its four corners. It contained all kinds of four-footed animals, as well as reptiles and birds of the air. Then a voice told him, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." "Surely not, Lord," Peter replied. "I have never eaten anything impure or unclean." The voice spoke to him a second time. Do not call anything impure that God has made clean. This happened three times, and immediately the sheet was taken back into heaven. Now, I think it's interesting because he says, surely not Lord. Anybody catch the irony there? I'm saying you're Lord and Master, and anything you say, I will do, but surely no way am I going to listen to you. And did you notice, when the angel shows up to Cornelius, does it happen three times? Just once, right? So how come for Peter it happens three times? Well, for one, I think pretty easily you could say, you know, for the Jew, you're going totally against tradition. You're saying now it's okay to kill and eat. After all this time, it's not been okay, and now it's okay? So I think that hearing it a few times maybe had to sink in. And then I think back, you know, how many times did Peter deny Jesus? Three times. Coincidence? When Jesus died and he denied him, then he meets again with Peter after he's raised from the dead, and he asks him something. He says, do you love me? How many times was he asked that? Three times. I'm seeing a pattern here. And the question was, do you love me? Feed my sheep, right? Take care of my sheep. And by the way, it doesn't say my Jewish sheep, but we'll get to that later. So I think that repetition had multiple effects, but I think that, and Peter was a stubborn guy. You know, he's one of those apostles close to Jesus who had some amazing highs and some amazing lows. I think that for me, that's really encouraging because there are times where I've really missed the mark. And I think back to Peter and I go, well, he blew it lots of times. He denied the Lord for three times to these nobody people, you know, the people that he was denying the Lord to. They weren't anybody special. So that gives me hope when the Lord, but I think the Lord maybe did that for a reason so that he would get the message loud and clear. All right. Now we're going to read on a little bit more. So he's had this happen three times. Now, while Peter was wondering about the meaning of the vision, the men sent by Cornelius found out where Simon's house was and stopped at the gate. They called out, asking if Simon, who was known as Peter, was staying there. Now notice, while Peter was still thinking about the vision, the Spirit said to him, Simon, three men are looking for you, so get up and go downstairs. Do not hesitate to go with them, for I have sent them. Peter went down and said to the men, I'm the one you're looking for. Why have you come? The men replied, we have come from Cornelius the centurion. He is a righteous and God-fearing man who is respected by all the Jewish people. A holy angel told him to have you come to his house so that he could hear what you have to say. Then Peter invited the men into the house to be his guests. The next day, Peter started out with them, along with with some of the brothers from Joppa went along. The following day, he arrived in Caesarea. Cornelius was expecting them and called them together and had called together his relatives and close friends. As Peter entered the house, Cornelius met him and fell at his feet in reverence. I like this. Peter made him get up and he said, stand up, I am only a man myself. Talking with him, Peter went inside and found a large gathering of people. I think that's interesting. So Cornelius has just seen an angel. And he gives them orders, and he says, I'm going to go get this guy. He's going to come back. He's going to give you a message. Did he believe that he was coming back? I mean, he invited a lot of people. They were all there waiting when this guy arrives. I think that's super cool. And that shows his faith. He said to them, you are well aware that it is against our law for a Jew to associate with a Gentile or visit him. But God has shown me that I should not call any man impure or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without raising any objection. May I ask why you sent for me? Cornelius answered, 4 days ago I was in my house praying at this hour at 3 p.m. Suddenly a man in shining clothes stood before me and said, Cornelius, God has heard your prayer and remembered your gifts to the poor. Send to Joppa for Simon, who is called Peter. He is a guest at the home of Simon the Tanner, who lives by the sea. So I sent for you immediately, and it was good of you to come. Now we are all here in the presence of God to listen to everything the Lord had commanded you to tell us. Then Peter began to speak. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation who fear him and do what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, telling the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all? You know what happened throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God has appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Now, check this out. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers, there were six witnesses that come with them, just so they can share this back with the rest of the Jewish guys, okay? Who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles. For they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Sound familiar? This is just like what happened at Pentecost, right? With the Jewish people. Now it's happening to the Gentiles. Then Peter said, "Can anyone keep these people from being baptized with water? They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have." So he ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked Peter to stay with them for a few days. So I have a question. So these guys both have visions, right? It kind of seems like God's orchestrating this. Now my question is, does this go against what Jesus did? I mean, when you look at Jesus' life and death, and when you look at his life on earth as a man, did he hang out with the Jews? He did. But did he only hang out with the Jews? When he healed people, did they have to be Jewish? No. I mean, whether you were rich or you were poor, whether you were a Roman or a Jew, whether you were sick or healthy, whether you were demon-possessed, whether you were caught in adultery, whether you're a woman at the well in Samaria, did Jesus touch everyone? Everyone. Everyone. So this isn't a new thing. In fact, if you go back to, we talked a little bit earlier about Abraham, right? The father of the Jewish faith. God meets him when he's 75 years old and says, and he's childless, right? No children. And he says, "I'm going to make you a father of all nations. I'm going to bless all nations by your seed," right? So it doesn't say that he's just going to bless the Jewish people. He's going to bless everybody. And that was a prophecy that's fulfilled by this ministry. Jesus' life and death and resurrection was from everybody. Remember John 3:16? "For God so loved the world that every Jew that believes in Jesus should..." Is that what it says?
No.
No, it says everyone. Look around. That's all of us. Whether you're a Jew or you're a Gentile, this message was for all of us. It started with the Jews. It came first. Salvation came first to the Jew, but then to the Gentiles. And thank goodness that it did. Now, I have a question for you. Who in your heart and your mind is unworthy for salvation? Because if you're honest, you may have some people that you go, don't think they really deserve it. How about the child molester? Is there room in heaven for them? How about the coworker who's gay? How about the Syrian refugee? How about the prostitute? How about the drug user? Are they okay? Did Jesus die for them? Yeah. Yeah. And if you let it, this can touch your heart, because we don't want to do like the Jews did. The Jews, you know, in fact, Peter is going to have to go to bat. The Jews are not going to go, "Everything's okay." And those witnesses that came with Peter to watch all this happen, they're important to the story, because they're going to go back and tell the Jewish people, "Man, you should have seen it. The Holy Spirit, they came on. you know, just like they did for us Jewish believers, they came unto the Gentiles too. They're now clothed in the Spirit. They have the Holy Spirit too. So this message is for all of us. And I want to show you. So Peter, it's going to take some time, but this event that happens, it opens up the door for the gospel to go out to the ends of the earth, just like Jesus said. And this is, I wanted to read this a little bit further. This is in chapter 11 that Peter's going to talk. He says, "As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit came on them as it had come on us in the beginning. Then I remembered what the Lord had said, 'John baptized with the water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' So if God gave them the same gift he gave us, who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I to think I could oppose him?" When they heard this, they said they had no further objections and praised God, saying, "So then God has granted even the Gentiles repentance unto life." All right. David, I'm going to have you go ahead and come up, and we're going to do communion.
Great. What a great day to be here. And there's hardly anything more humbling than standing here, because I am no different than any one of you. I am just a sinner saved by grace, and that's the only reason we get to share the good news, is because we know that Jesus. And how do we know that I'm a sinner? Well, because God's word in Romans 3:10 says, "There is no one righteous, not even one." And if you go on to verse 23, it says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Jews, Gentiles, all. And a couple of weeks ago, if you were here, you heard Izzy talk about, he talked about Paul. And, you know, in 1 Timothy 1:15, Paul says, "It is a trustworthy statement deserving full acceptance that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, among whom I am foremost of all." And that's the New American Standard. In King James, it says, "This is a faithful saying and worthy of all exception, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief." New Living Testament says, "This is a trustworthy saying, and everyone should accept it. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, and I am the worst of them all." The Message, I don't know if you ever read Peterson's Message Bible, but it's I like it once in a while. Here's a word you can take to heart and depend on. Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. I'm proof. Public sinner number one. And this is Paul. This is Paul. We have churches and cathedrals named after St. Paul. What could he have done? If you continue on in Acts in 7, actually it's, I guess, a couple chapters before what Aaron was talking about. Towards the end of chapter 7 there and into chapter 8. "When they had driven him," that is Stephen, "out of the city, they began stoning him. And the witnesses laid aside their robes at the feet of a young man named Saul. They went on stoning Stephen as he called on the Lord and said, 'Lord Jesus, receive my spirit.' Then falling on his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, 'Lord, do not hold this sin against them.' Having said this, he fell over dead." Asleep, as it says in there. Acts chapter 8, Saul was in hearty agreement with putting him to death. Now, have any of us stood by while a murder was taking place? Perhaps. Something that comes to my mind is abortion, of course. I don't know if you've participated. Guys, have you stood by? Then in verse 3, "But Saul began ravaging the church, entering house after house and dragging off men and women. He would put them in prison." Now in Acts 9, Saul is continuing his persecution of believers. But then what happens? Jesus gets his attention, doesn't he? I mean, boom, knocks him off the horse. Saul is wondering what happened, and what does Jesus ask him? "Why are you persecuting my church?" That was a pretty serious thing, and Jesus got his attention, and what happened? Saul became a new creature in Christ. He got a new name, Paul. a new creature in Christ, just like each and every one of us can be. And we don't need to compare sins. I mean, sin is sin. I mean, you got lists of, I've got my own. Don't ask my wife. And yet Jesus came as a sacrifice for each and every one of us. For me, for you. There's a local Big Island church that has this welcome. And it comes with a warning. It says, "Be aware. Here we practice the inclusive gospel of Jesus Christ. This means that you may be gathering with tax collectors, thieves, adulterers, addicts, hypocrites, women as well as men, female and male priests, gays and lesbians, the disabled, the dying, Native Americans, Native Hawaiians, Mexicans, Asians, blacks, and other ethnic minorities, bishops, bigots, heretics, agnostic, atheists, Jews, Muslim, Hindus, Buddhist, and strangers from foreign lands. Anyone like those with whom Jesus met." So beware, this is not an exclusive club. We welcome you all. And that is so true of the church. And yet, as Aaron said, is there somebody that we would look at and say, I'm not sure about them? Maybe their political beliefs are a little bit wacko. Or maybe their environment beliefs are, they're wasting so much. There's room for everyone. Jesus died for each and every one of us. Romans 10:13, everyone who calls on the name of Jesus will be saved. So we've all sinned, but we're all welcome. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And then on in 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The gift of eternal life is God's gift to us. Have you ever gotten a real special gift? Something that might have been recently, might have been a long time ago, and yet you remember it's special. I'll show you something that's a special gift to me. It's a gold cross. I got it from a beautiful woman almost 35 years ago. My bride, it was a wedding gift. The chain, after about, 16 years or so, started to fray, and I needed a new chain. I happened to be with a very special man in my life. He needed a new battery for his watch, and so we went in, and at age 89, he's with a walker, and I thought, he can handle this by himself. He was doing that, and I was looking around, and I found, I like that chain. That man was my dad. That was my last trip I had with him, and he passed away about a month after that. So this is a special gift for me. Reminds me of some special people. The cross because of Jesus, because it was a gift from my wife, and because the chain reminds me of my dad. Some pretty special people. I'm sure you can relate to that, those sorts of gifts. Now, what about the gift of salvation? Wow. How do we remember that? What was the cost? We talk about it being free. Sometimes you hear about a free promotion on TV or whatever, and that ain't worth nothing. It's just some cheap gift, right? What was the cost of this eternal life? It cost God a great deal, His only begotten Son. Could you do that? Would you do that? Ooh. Abraham was tested, and he was willing. If I had to sacrifice my only child, boy, I'd want to jump in there and first say, hey, at least take me. Don't take. And yet, God sacrificed His Son. And Jesus was obedient. Isaiah 53, there's a lot of good things in there, but verse 7 says, He was oppressed and He was afflicted, yet He did not open His mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, so He did not open His mouth. Now you can read in Matthew and some of the Gospels. Matthew 27, verse 12, while He was being accused by the chief priests and elders, He did not answer. Pilate said to Him, do you not hear many things they're testifying against you? And He did not answer him with regard to a single charge. literally didn't answer a single word. Now, why was Jesus silent on that? Have you ever been accused of something that you didn't do? What's your reaction? Boy, it's wrong. I'm going to tell them that it's wrong, right? Jesus couldn't refute the accusations. He couldn't deny the sin because it was mine. It was yours. That's why he was silent. He didn't deserve that. He had no sin, but he had mine. And in that position, he couldn't defend. The sacrifice had to be made. Now, he's my advocate today, and I thank God for that, that he's my advocate, and he's saying, Father, forgive him, and I need it every day. But he was silent because of my sin and your sin. He was obedient unto death. So the cost of this free gift of salvation was very costly to God. Now, do you remember when you first received the gift of salvation? Boy, I can remember. Who were you with? Were you on a beach? Were you in an auditorium? Were you in a church? Were you with some friends? Were you out camping? Who was there with you? You know, mom and dad, some good friends. Some good memories can come from that. What if you haven't had that experience yet? If you have not accepted the gift of salvation, what better day? What better place? What a great memory this would be on the beach with these sinners. This is the time. No better place, no better group of people. So if you haven't, just say that now. God, I acknowledge your Son as Jesus, and I know he rose from the dead and is my Savior. And you're part of the family of God. Barry and Daniel are going to get ready for the for communion. And in 1 Corinthians, again, we come back to Paul. Paul is writing this, as he wrote many of the books of the Bible that we have today. And he's repeating what Jesus said in Matthew, in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, what we call or refer to the Last Supper. These were Jesus' words that he says. Paul is saying this. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." We talked about memories. Do you remember that day when you first accepted the gift of salvation? Was it today? We get to do this in remembrance of Jesus. This is what he's told us to do. Whenever we do it, this is a great place to celebrate communion together. This is a great place to remember what Jesus' sacrifice was. Some of us have been able to do this maybe at home with just our family. That's a great experience. Perhaps you and maybe just you and your mom, maybe just you and your dad, maybe just you and a loved one can celebrate together. Maybe they haven't been feeling well, haven't been able to get out. Maybe you can celebrate this. Or maybe you can remember Jesus, because that's what he's asked us to do. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, again, in remembrance of me." Jesus says to remember him. Remember his sacrifice. Remember the gift that you have, the gift of eternal life to spend with him. What a day that will be when we are there surrounding the throne. Wow. You know, I guess there's a, will I get to see my dad again? We can speculate about that. I don't know that I'll even, by the time I get there, I'll probably want to see him, but I'll be so enamored with just praising Jesus that oh, good, glad you're here, Dad. Let's go. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. He is coming back. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink of the cup. So this is just a moment for us to examine ourselves. Daniel, I'll grab one. Examine ourselves, and in so doing, give thanks and remember the sacrifice that Jesus has made for us. What do you remember about his sacrifice? It was costly, and it's very personal. For each of us, it's personal. I'm sure if we were to ask everyone here, there may be some similarities, but it would be, we're all unique, and that's how much God loves us. You have the, Kaiwa, does Barry have the mic? As we give thanks, I'm going to ask Barry to pray just over the bread, and we'll partake together afterwards. Barry?
Okay. Dear Lord, be with us all today. During the Passover, you gave us a new command that we love one another. I pray that our love would grow for each other and for all the members of our community. Please guide us, Lord, and thank you for this opportunity. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
And Jesus said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." How can we say thank you? This is always troubling for me. We don't have enough words in English, I don't think, to say thank you. You know, somebody opens the door for you, you say thank you. Jesus gave his life for me, for all eternity. There's got to be more than just thank you. I would pray that we, our lives would be a resounding symbol of thanks to our Lord Jesus. And Father, as we're reminded, Jesus, that you, this is your blood that you shed for us, your sacrifice, and we are remembering that. We're remembering the gift of your salvation that you have given to us. We remember that as we take this together and say thank you, and knowing that's inadequate, but again, we pray that our lives would be a reflection of thanksgiving, that we can share the good news with others. We thank you in Jesus' name. We share together. Think about how you can say thank you. I think we've got a closing song or two. Thank you.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.